So this forum here, the debate showcase, is also a chance for us to learn from you. You see, we are about to call to the stage 8 of our top speakers from 8 different countries. These top speakers are 8 out of over 1,500. Clearly, there are more than 8 great speakers in this room. Clearly, there are more than 8 speakers who deserve to be the ones on this stage. It is simply a matter of numbers as much as it is nominations. And thus, one reason we open the debate showcase to participation from the audience after the debate itself is because we want many of you to add your voices to the conversation. We learn more from your voices combined than we would learn from any one voice individually, and there is no greater, more diverse combination of voices in the program than here at the Global Round every year. So during that prep time, while the teams on stage are preparing, I do ask you very sincerely to prepare to share some comments of your own, comments on your opinion of the motion. Do not feel you need to argue against any particular person on the stage. As someone contributing to the discussion, it is not about personal attacks or individual feedback. It is about joining the bigger conversation. So please try to do that. Yesterday we had a great conversation with the juniors. We look forward to an even bigger, better, and probably louder one with the seniors. All right, so these 8 speakers will lead us in a debate. Who will be their judges? There's a little uncertainty, but in fact, the judges will be additional nominated scholars who also received tremendous scores yesterday on their debates, are not on the stage because of the fact that we can only have 8 speakers on stage, but these scholars will have their own private debate. This panel of judges, once the debate is over, will be escorted to a secret chamber, actually not sure where it is, where they will discuss the outcome and render a verdict, and then they will return and share that verdict with us. So, I believe it is time to begin announcing who these speakers are in the debate showcase.
All right, and as Daniel said, once we announce your name, please do bring the things you need for a debate. There are Wi-Fi passes for you on your table. So one of your prizes is you get Wi-Fi access.
It will last for 48 hours, so enjoy.
All right.
Probably better than a jury at this point in the week. No. All right.
Start with the first speaker.
Let's begin with the affirmative team. Where will the affirmative team seat?
They will sit here.
Very good. Our first speaker is from Thailand, from NIST International School. Who is it? Alessandro Prugel. Alessandro, please join us on stage.
You may have to use the tuk-tuk ramp. Our second speaker comes to us from Taiwan. From Kaohsiung American School, it is Dylan Croft.
Our third speaker joins us from India, from Vales International School, Nudara Yusuf.
Rounding off the affirmative team, I'm very proud to announce this. From my own country, from Canada, from Sir Winston Churchill Secondary School, Molly McKay.
And as these scholars join us on stage, let's have one more round of applause for all the affirmative team speakers together. We move to the negative, the opposition. Our first speaker on the negative team is from Malaysia, but not from Kuala Lumpur, and not from Penang. This speaker is from Marlborough College, Malaysia, James Gibson. Yep, some microphones are going to get broken. Paramedics to the third row.
They're like in a team huddle before they sit down.
Affirmative team, in case it helps with your strategizing, you do not need to speak in the order that you have been announced.
No,
they're too deep in their conversation.
They're good, intense team huddle. All right, our second speaker from the negative team comes to us from Kenya, from Rusinga School in Nairobi. It is Joy McKenna Gachara.
Our third speaker joins us from Brazil. From the American School of Rio de Janeiro, Amy Watts.
And rounding off the negative team from Indonesia, from the Mentari School of Jakarta, it is Kyla Christie Hambali.
Don't drop her. They dropped her. Can we have confirmation that the Rusinga School is here in the hall? Great.
Let's have a round of applause for our negative team. Oh, they're making friends.
Very good. Community.
Good community.
And now we will announce the panel of judges that will determine the outcome of this debate.
When we call your name, please make your way to the front row. Front row over here, and bring all your things with you.
Our first panelist is Kanya Sachadevi Sujiarto.
Our second panelist is Philip Nagare.
Followed by Ashik Kaur.
Our fourth panelist is Chisiva Zafira.
Followed by Siddhak Ahuja.
Our next panelist is Burke Roberts.
And next is Zekithelo Thwala.
Our next panelist is Jenny Fang.
Followed by Cecilia Chen. One panelist is bringing a Captain America shield.
Our next panelist is Ingrid Banman.
And our final panelist, Miyuki Shiraki. So scholars of the global round, you have your affirmative team. They're still strategizing. You have your negative team. You have your judges. What do you need? A motion. The motion of today's debate showcase. Resolved that childhood is becoming more imperfect.
Showcase speakers, you have 15 minutes to prepare. And can we play some music while they're preparing? Good luck.
And that is the end of the planning time for our debate showcase teams. Scholars, audience, before we begin, can you guys give them another huge round of applause? Give them some encouragement, show them some love. Some of them are your teammates, some of them are your friends. Support them. We're in store for a great debate here. Now, before we begin and call up the first speaker, in the debate showcase, many of you may know that the time warning for when your speech is closing or coming to an end, we involve Jerry in that. But before we do that, a bit of a story about the Jerry that's going to be involved in this. We have one of our giant Jerrys down here in the front. Can you hold him up? This Jerry was rescued to us by the delegation from Oshawa Academy in Nairobi because he was lost about 2 months ago when we traveled there for the Nairobi 2 round. Emirates Airlines lost him. And he was located, and they brought him all the way to the global round for us. And he will be showing you when your speech is coming to a close. So when you reach the 3-minute mark, if you see that giant Jerry waving back and forth, like that, that means you have 1 minute left. And if you reach the full 4 minutes, you will see him fly up in the air to let you know to wrap up your speech. But without further ado, we are ready for this debate. And it is my pleasure to call up the first speaker from the affirmative team. Please introduce yourself, and you may begin.
Good afternoon, scholars. I am Alessandro, and I'll be arguing on the affirmative side on the motion that childhood is becoming more imperfect. So, to begin with, we should probably first define what imperfect is. I mean, a childhood has many aspects to it. Imperfection in childhood is when the childhood isn't fulfilled, when you don't feel like it was complete, when you feel like the things you earned you didn't really earn, when you feel like everything you've done didn't really amount to what it should have amounted to. And so it's a very emotional connection that we have with our childhood, and that is exactly what makes it our childhood. Now, continuing on, what is a childhood, right? You're right to ask. So a childhood is composed of a few very essential parts. Childhood, first of all, is discovery. Discovery of new things, discovery of new information. And that information is part of childhood. It's discovered in a very childish way because we discover it ourselves, because we go out and we experience these things. And the reason we don't experience them anymore is simply that a lot of information is handed to us. It is given to us. And reading something, being told something, often that doesn't have as deep a connection. We don't lose the specific information, but we lose the connection, the personal connection that we have to that information. And that is why discovery, as an aspect of childhood, has been in the decline and continues to decline. And so, moving on, we get into this whole aspect of adventure. And childhood is really sprinkled with adventure. We have a lot of it. At least, I hope you had a lot of it, because if not, the motion's been more advanced than we thought. Essentially, adventure is a great aspect of a childhood, and a child has to be allowed to go out and discover things and have an adventure, to go out and do things that they think are strange, that they think are dangerous. And even though the world seems to be becoming more safe by the minute, there's less things you can get hurt with, there's higher life expectancy, things become better, even though all of these facts, children don't get to play outside as much. And that's because parents become overprotective, because society has become overprotective of children. And we don't allow them to go out and discover and have an adventure by themselves anymore. Lastly, through that, through this whole rigidness that society has gained, we lose relationships. Children lose that essential part of childhood that is the relationship with your friends and most of all your family. So relationships with your family become more incomplete, they become less deep, very superficial, and you get situations in which parents and children don't really get along, in which you have kids sitting next to each other doing individual things, although they could be doing something together. And I know that sounds very cliche, but it's true. And so, yes, those are the three essential parts of childhood, and that, in essence, is why childhood is becoming more imperfect. Thank you.
Thank you very much for kicking this debate off. Negative speakers, negative team, you have 1 minute to prepare before your first speaker.
Today, we will be arguing why childhood is not becoming more imperfect. Now, before I start, I'd like to talk about what we think is becoming more imperfect. And that's a situation in which the children of our world are becoming unhappier, are becoming less safe. And then we're going to take a look at the evidence, and it's going to very much show that this resolution is false and that we all should disagree with it. Now, allow me first to rebut a couple of things from our respectable first speaker, who said that we are no longer able to go out and explore. That's not true. The parks outside are not going anywhere. We're still able to go. Sure, maybe some parents are a bit more strict. That's not the end of the world. That doesn't mean you can't explore anymore. And then you have other areas to consider. Now, our arguments will be as follows. I personally will be talking about why this new generation has new sources of happiness that we can rely on top of the old sources of happiness. Then, my colleagues will also be talking about health and peace in global conflict. So let's look at mine, happiness and technology. My dad could have fun by going outside, trying to climb a tree, failing, trying again. I can also do that. But on top of that, I have all these other things I can also do to make myself happier, to have a more enjoyable childhood. Did anybody play Mini Clip or like Club Penguin when they were growing up? Exactly, that was fun too. We got to have that on top of the trees. We got these games, we got Wii's on top of the tree climbing, and we're so lucky for that. On top of that, our childhoods, our growing childhoods, we get far more access to each other's cultures than any other generation in history. My mother, who is Japanese, she grew up in a fairly big city, but she didn't see an individual of darker skin until she was in her 20s. That's crazy. We are so lucky. Look at this room right now. 20 minutes ago, I was talking to a Canadian-Iranian guy. That's incredible. My mom would be so jealous of me. And that's because my childhood, fortunately, is a little bit better than hers. Finally, my opponent talked about relationships and how they're being damaged. I would definitely agree that our relationships are changing. That, no contest. But are they really getting worse? On top of the speaking face-to-face that he mentioned, which, by the way, we can still do. I'm kind of doing that to you guys right now. Hey, how's it going? We also have all these other means of communication. I spent 9 years living in China, and then I moved to Brazil. But I was still able to keep in contact, weekly contact, with some of the best friends you could ask for. And so my childhood, both in Brazil and China, saw me talking to these people from Japan, from Brazil, from Israel, and the UK and Korea. In short, I have been incredibly lucky. My childhood has been really great, and I think the majority of childhoods today are also in that situation where we have so many more options, so many more sources of happiness, whether that's technology improvements in Skype, or with bubble trouble, or as we will see later, with health and with conflict resolution. In short, childhood is definitely not becoming more imperfect, and we are very fortunate that that is the case. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Affirmative team, you have 1 minute to prepare your next speaker. And affirmative team, we are ready for the second speaker of your team.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Nadara Yusuf, I'm from India, and I'm gonna be the second speaker of the affirmative team, stating that the childhood is becoming more imperfect. Now, I'd like to start off with a little bit of rebuttal from the opposition team. And they said that we have access to more culture because the world is becoming more globalized. Well, let's look at this. The main argument against globalization is that culture is being lost, is that ethnicity is being lost, and culture is a huge part of any person's childhood. That culture and that family and that relation and belonging you have is something that builds a base and a foundation for the the rest of your life. So now on that point, let's talk about family, that foundation, that sense of belonging. I hate to admit it, and I hate to tell the opposition that we're no longer in an ideal world, all right? But this foundation, this belonging, is definitely deteriorating. There aren't as many children that feel that sense of, I can tell my parents anything. My parents will never lie to me. I can be who I am with my friends, with my parents. I like to look every single one of you in the eye and say, is that really the case? Are you the same person with your parents than you are with your friends? Do you really have that childhood attachment that our parents had with our grandparents? Is that the case? So what I want to say is this leads to superficial childhoods. So if you have a fake foundation, is that really going to give you a strong building? A superficial childhood can affect a child's life. How many of your parents came to football games, came to basketball games, came to baseball games? And how many do that now? How many say, oh, I'm sorry, I have work, I'm sorry, I can't really come? Family is a huge point in someone's childhood, and it is losing, and thus it is becoming more imperfect. And now let's talk about safety. They said that we're much, that safety is not, is more, like there's more safety, right? Well, we're saying no. Let's talk about the internet, which is something they talked about as well. Cyberbullying, cyber crimes. There's so many of these. So many children are being bullied. So many children are being kidnapped because of this cyber facility that we have in today's day and age. Our point in today's debate is not to say that there are good parts of childhood. We're saying there are parts of childhood and they are being lost. They are being more imperfect. So that is all we need to define in this debate. Again, as my first speaker said, we're not saying life is any worse. We're not saying that life is any better. We're saying childhood, that feeling of childhood, that emotional attachment you have with people as a child, that stage in your life is being lost. How many of you already feel the pressure to go do well, to go into universities? How many of you already feel like in sixth grade, I need to do well in exams so that I can have a bright future? That sense of freedom and enjoyment is being lost in today's day and age. And it's only gonna get worse. I know that all of you feel the same way. And so our motion today is that childhood is becoming more imperfect. It's not that life is becoming more imperfect. It's not that safety is becoming more imperfect. It's that childhood, that sense of feeling as a child, is more imperfect. And I believe we have proven that to you today. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. Negative team, you have 1 minute before the second speaker of your team takes the stage. Your second speaker can approach the microphone in the center of the room.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Joy McKenna, and I will be negating today's motion that childhood is becoming more imperfect. So my team and I are not saying that our childhood is perfect. We all understand we're living in an imperfect world, and so even our childhood is imperfect. But is it becoming more imperfect? Now, our worthy opponent spoke about cyberbullying. Do you know how many types of bullying we have? We have the physical bullying where it happens in school. Do you know there's even bullying between siblings? And people actually commit suicide just because of your bigger brother, your bigger sister. There's so many kinds of bullying. And sometimes, honestly, it's hard to avoid it sometimes. But guess what? With cyberbullying, you can simply press block. So simple. Can you block your sister off? Can you block your brother off? Then she spoke, our worthy opponents also spoke about kidnapping. We know that it's possible for children to be kidnapped through technology, how it's advanced. And that is why we came up with an Amber Alert. If you have been reading your World Scholar syllabus, we have the Amber Alert, which is becoming better actually to solve this case. And let me ask you, I'm asking you as an individual, if there was no, for example, technology, there was no source of communication with the outside world, would you know that there's a country out there called Spain and they speak Spanish and they dance like this, dance like that? Would you know that? But guess, and culture, we learn how to share culture. Before, I only knew about my culture when I was younger. I only knew about Kenya. What about Kenya? We speak Swahili, jambo, jambo, sasa feet. But now I can say bonjour, I can say konnichiwa, and I learned here, I think I say sawadika. I say that. And how did I do that? How? It's because of the development in our childhood. So now I want to talk about the health, how health has improved our childhood. I have an uncle who, when he was young, he got polio, unfortunately. And he was really smart, someone who had a big dream. He was really smart, used to pass his exams. But unfortunately, because of poverty, my grandma couldn't take him to any hospital. They lived in complete poverty. He got polio. And from then on, his life was downstream. So right now, he's about 50 years old, and that's when he's trying to come up. But he's still struggling, and he has a wife, two children. He's still doing his best. But what about you? You got your vaccine as a child. Now imagine if you did not get that vaccine. Would you be seated here? Would you be able to come watch this debate and even debate with other people? I don't think so. So yes, we know that our world is not perfect, but it is not in any way becoming more imperfect. Thank you.
Thank you, affirmative team. 1 minute before your next team member speaks.
Honorable adjudication, audience, worthy opposition, and my teammates. I, Dylan Croft from Kaohsiung American School, am the third speaker for the team in strong affirmation of the motion that childhood is becoming more imperfect. An imperfect childhood is one where you do not feel complete. There is no longer a sense of fulfillment, a sense of completeness, a sense of wholesomeness. As the third speaker, I shall be elaborating on this point of discovery as an important aspect of childhood, and refuting some of the opposition's claims. First and foremost, discovery. When we talk about childhood, we are discussing the abstract concept of childhood instead of this physical well-being, this physical life expectancy, these physical aspects of childhood. We are talking about the abstract concept of feeling complete and feeling fulfilled. I could not stand up here and tell you the first device that I got. Was it my cell phone, my iPad, my laptop computer? No, I would not know. I could, however, tell you clearly what was the first piece of electronic my father got. An LCD calculator with 9 buttons that were green. I could tell you exactly what he got, because he worked hard and he earned it. Doing what he knew he could and slowly working his way to get it. He was not given this. He did not ask for it. He earned it. And that is an important aspect of childhood. Not being given, but earning. And that is what we mean when we say childhood is becoming more imperfect. We are no longer given these opportunities to earn what we get, but instead we are being given. We are given so much instead of earning what we should. The opposition had made the claim that there is still bullying, and we fully acknowledge that there is still bullying. And in fact, it supports our stance that this bullying is not getting better. Cyberbullying, physical bullying, whatever, is not getting better. It's only getting worse. Is only growing more imperfect. The opposition has claimed that in this new generation, there are new sources of happiness. Yes, you can still climb a tree, but you can also use Mini Clip or Club Penguin. That is true. However, we are saying that these opportunities to explore what only a child can explore are being taken away, and instead, we are experiencing things we can do so much further down the line and instead neglecting what we can only do as children. We are sacrificing what we can only do in our youth in favor of what we can do forever as we live on. And that is, at the core, the reason why childhood is becoming more imperfect. We are losing our sense of childhood because we are no longer experiencing to its fullest extent. The opposition had made the claim that there are more cultures to explore. You can speak a few words from many different languages. But how well do you fully understand your own culture? We are experiencing a little bit of everything, but never fully experiencing what we have. We are now a jack of all trade, but a master of none. We are overwhelmed with so many options, so many choices, that we do not know where to take. In fact, my third teammate from regional rounds could not make it here because he had to go to the United States to look at colleges. He does not know where he wants to go, but there is a wealth of options for him that he can never make up his mind. Instead of spending his time doing what a child should, he is spending his time worrying about what an adult should. On this idea of growing, relationships growing increasingly superficial. I could go back from the global round with 100 new Facebook friends. I could go back from an MUN competition with more friends. However, do I really know them? Sure, I might see them next year and say hi. But these relationships, so many everywhere, they're growing increasingly superficial. You no longer have strong connections with a few people, but instead weak ones with many. And does this truly mean that childhood is still the same? No. It means that your childhood is growing more imperfect as you are no longer experiencing what you should, but what adults tell you you should. These familial bonds are disintegrating because instead of asking your parents to help you with something, you look straight towards Google and occasionally Bing. You no longer go to your parents to ask them, how do I shave? Instead, you go to Wiki Answers. These things that your parents or close family members might teach you, they're no longer happening because you look toward the internet. And with these points brought forth, this motion must stand. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Negative team, you have 1 minute to prepare for your third speaker.
My timer started?
You may begin.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am James Gibson from Malaysia, and I'll be acting as the negative side's third speaker. So naturally, I would like to begin with some rebuttal. First of all, to the second speaker, tell me our culture is not as relevant as it was before to the children in this room. Do you think they've lost their culture? Tell me they've lost their culture when you see the smiles on their faces, when their country appears on that screen. Tell me they've lost their culture when you hear their excited voices at the cultural fair. Tell me you have lost your culture when we as a whole group of people have relished in each and every one of our own culture and shared it with every other person in this room. Now, for the third speaker, you stressed this point about how children have to earn what we get, not be given it. However, aren't children fundamentally and naturally supposed to be taken care of? Aren't we supposed to be given things by our parents, such as food, a home, shelter? Isn't that a natural human right anyway? Furthermore, your whole concept of earning it is something that definitely doesn't apply today compared to 100 years ago. In fact, according to the University of Iowa, in the 1900s, in factories, children were often preferred because they were more manageable and they were cheaper labor. So they had to work 12-hour shifts because their parents couldn't get jobs and they needed to supply food for their parents and they had to earn it themselves. Compared to Furthermore, the third speaker said that exam stress is too much of our lives. However, is exam stress worse than stressing about whether you can eat tomorrow? Whether you can make enough money? Whether you can make enough money at your 12-hour shift to support your family, to stay in home, to be able to feed people. Now, to my point. As a global society, we've had an over 50-year-long period of global peace. We have not engaged in a global war since 1945. We have organized international communities dedicated to preventing this from ever happening again. No longer do children have to live in fear? Do they have to worry whether their parents come home from the war? Children don't have to sit on the hatred between countries and bear emotional scars for a lifetime. How many of you have to experience that nowadays? If you wouldn't call that more perfect than 100 years ago, I don't know what it was. Now, obviously, I'm not saying there are no wars. There are areas of conflict around the globe, and there are children who spend their childhood in these areas. However, the motion for debate is that childhood is becoming more imperfect. But I would disagree that childhood is more imperfect from 70 years ago, when you live a fear of being sent to a concentration camp because you're Jewish. Furthermore, we as a society are not ignoring the conflict that exists today. We have the United Nations. We have countless NGOs that are dedicated to peace, to developing countries, to preventing conflict, and to ensuring the safety of our children today and ensuring that they have a childhood. So let me finish by stressing, our childhood is not becoming more imperfect. We have improved as a society. We have dedicated ourselves to peace, to avoiding conflict, to ensuring the children of today have a safer and better childhood than those of yesterday, and therefore a more perfect childhood. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that impassioned speech. Affirmative team, you have 1 minute before your final speaker. Audience, it's just a few minutes from when you will have the opportunity to share your thoughts about this motion, so if you do have ideas, keep them in mind. Your turn is coming up soon. Affirmative team, 1 minute. We are now ready for the fourth and the final speaker from our affirmative team in this debate showcase. Please introduce yourself and begin.
Hi, my name is Molly McClay, and I'm from Canada. Side Negative has told you that essentially the world is getting better. As society progresses, we can expect certain advancements. We can expect a higher life expectancy. We can expect to have less conflict. But it is because we want what is best for our children in the present. It is because we want every individual around the world to be able to develop to their fullest potential that we are so proud to continue to propose this motion today. As your final speaker, I will be analyzing this round with three questions. First, what kind of childhood promotes better learning? Second, what kind of childhood promotes better relationships? And third, what kind of childhood is happiest? Let's get straight into that first question. What kind of childhood promotes better learning? An idea that has come up in both sides of the house is about the internet, right? They've told you that new information is available to us and therefore our childhood is more perfect. But we would tell you that the internet is not the best way to foster a child's learning. We would tell you that when a flow of information is hitting children so hard that they don't know what to analyze and they don't know what to deem as important, that is not the best way to have a childhood. But further, they bring you this idea of culture, right? They tell you that globalization has improved and therefore childhood is better. We would tell you that knowing fragments of everything does not get us any closer to perfection. Let me ask you this. How many of you are wearing your traditional clothes from your home country? We had to have a fair in order to express our ideas because that's the only time that we actually feel any connection to our own culture. Next question, what kind of childhood promotes better familial relationships? We brought you this whole idea of superficiality, right? We would tell you that there's not as much face-to-face contact with your parents, there's not as much face-to-face contact with your friends, and overall, relationships during childhood are becoming more imperfect. What did they say in response to this? All they said is you can still go out and climb a tree. You can still have conversations face-to-face. We understand that some of these aspects, of course, are possible, but what we are saying is that they are negated by all the outside information that is coming to us now. We would tell you that yes, you can talk face to face, but we don't as much as we used to, and that is extremely harmful on the development of children. Next, we talked about what kind of childhood is happiest. This is the most important point in this debate. We brought you this idea of stress, right? We told you that cyberbullying provides more avenues for bullying to occur. We also told you that education systems are putting way too much pressure on students and making test scores way more important than actual learning. The only response they had to this was that bullying can occur anyway and stress isn't that big of a deal. We would tell you that when children are reduced to tears because of a certain mark they achieved on a test, that is not the kind of childhood we want to promote. Next, we get onto this idea of safety, right? They tell you we have a safer world and therefore childhood is more important. It doesn't matter how safe the world is if parents don't believe that it is safe. If parents are keeping their children inside for fear that their kid will get kidnapped, that is not a way to have a happy childhood when fear is controlling the lives of these children. Next, we have this idea of adventure, how we need to be discovering new things in order to have a fulfilling childhood and in order to live a childhood to our full potential. We would tell you that in the present day, we don't earn anything anymore. Everything is being handed to us, and that is not what we want for the children of this world. Side Negative has told you that the childhood of yesterday is worse than the childhood of today. But we would tell you that we are looking for the children of tomorrow, and that is why we have won this debate today. Thank you.
Thank you for that and for the entire affirmative team. Negative team, you have 1 minute before your fourth speaker and the final speaker in this debate showcase. Please introduce yourself and begin.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kyla. I'm from Indonesia, Mentari School, Jakarta. And I am the last speaker of the negative team going against the motion that childhood is becoming more imperfect. Now, there's an interesting perspective from the affirmative team that our childhoods now are not happier. Now, let me ask you, are you less happier than your parents? Are you satisfied with your own childhood? Because I am. Now, the first speaker said that the important thing about our childhood now is that we're losing personal connections. How many of you here introduced yourselves and immediately gave each other Snapchats? Technology itself has become the link that is able to connect all of us together in personal ways that sometimes we just can't do face-to-face. Sometimes face-to-face isn't always possible. Sometimes physical connections are not always possible, and technology now allows us to elaborate on that, allows us to help us bridge that gap. And the first speaker said the word rigid. In what world is our generation now rigid? I would say that our generation is the most fluent, the most flowing generation there is out there. Our technological advances and medical advances, as well as my second speaker has stated, has shown enough of our progress for it to be rigid. The second speaker talked about how culture is lost, and as well as the last speaker also did. I'm wearing a flag of my own country on my shirt. My teammate is wearing a bracelet from her own country. I would like to say that not showing culture all the time does not mean we are not connected with our culture. And furthermore, technology has enabled us to connect with other cultures, allowing us to enrich our own cultures, allowing us to understand so many other types of cultures. And you talked about the foundation of belonging and how now a lot of parents are pressuring their children to take tests. This has happened since the dawn of time. Parents have been pressuring their children since the dawn of time. The Chinese told their daughters to bound their feet. There have been pressures on arranged marriage and male roles. It's been happening since the dawn of time. Nothing has changed. Our world is not becoming more imperfect. And you also negated our fact on cyberbullying. I would like to say that cyberbullying does exist. And bullying has existed, again, since the dawn of time. But our technology now and our advances into the future has allowed us to be more aware of what bullying is. And create more steps to stop it and create more steps to advocate non-bullying. So the fact that bullying still exists, yes, that's true, but we are taking measures to stop it. The third speaker talked about being complete and fulfilled and happiness. Again, how do you measure happiness? How can you say for sure that generations, as they go forward, they are becoming less happy? That's not possible. Have you interviewed every single child in the world and shown that that person is not happy? The fourth speaker talked about overload of information. This shows that information has increased. And the fact that they're talking about exams shows that education has increased. All of these values has allowed a child to improve in their lives, allowed them to develop even more. The fact that information is more accessible to the point where it can be an overload itself is a proof that we are advancing as a society, advancing as children, advancing our children of the future, exactly as our first speaker has stated. And the last point she said was about stress. When in the world has stress ever not been present? When in the world has stress not been there? The fact now that we are so advanced in psychological advancements as well, we're able to negate that, we're able to eradicate, we're able to stop stress, we're able to know how more to lessen stress. My first speaker talked about how our childhood is best with technological sources of happiness. So that completely negates the last point, where we're basically saying that it's only the well-being. It's not. We are happy. And my second speaker talked about health has improved, and my third speaker talked about global peace. I would like to close with the fact that we are all here. Us as a generation, we are all here and present. Our culture is proud. We are happy. Thank you.
Thank you, and you guys, give all the debate showcase participants up on stage a big round of applause, make some noise for them. They did a wonderful job. It is always amazing to see what can be done with a group that is formed from individuals called from a group as large as this in just 15 minutes. Great job, we are not done yet though. Our panelists who are sitting in the front row now need to be taken backstage so that they can begin what will be a very difficult decision, deciding which of our debate showcase teams has ultimately won this debate. As our panelists are leaving, audience, our community, this is now your opportunity to join the discussion. If you have an idea or a burning comment that you would like to add, maybe something that was not included in the speaker's speeches up here, this is your chance to share that. We have microphones placed throughout the hall, in the aisles. If you would like to share something, as many of you are doing now, please form a line behind those. There are many of you here. So many, in fact, that there will not be enough time for every one of you to share your ideas. To make sure that we can have as many people as possible, we do ask you to keep your comments short. In fact, you will only have 30 seconds. You will know you only have 30 seconds because the time will be displayed up on the screen, letting you know how much time you have remaining. So when that time runs out, we do ask you to stop and allow the next person to share their ideas. A couple other guidelines. Remember, this is about continuing the conversation. It is not about giving feedback to the teams up on stage or individual comments to individual speakers. This is about sharing your ideas. The speakers up on stage will not have a chance to respond. Keep that in mind. And could we get that timer up on the screen? All right. That is the timer up there. We will start right here in the middle. If you do go up to the mic before you share your ideas, please introduce yourself, tell us your name, which school you're from, and then you may share whatever it is that you have to share. Do keep in mind the time. We will move through these quickly, and we'll start right here in the middle.
I'm Thomas Savage, the only senior scholar from Bromsgrove International School, Thailand, and I wanted to talk about cultural evolution, that in today's world, through globalization, we're not losing our own cultures, they're just evolving by natural selection. The bits of cultures that held us back previously, well, our cultures were built on things such as racism and sexism, and those things are going away because our cultures are evolving. So we're not sticking to those because they're bad. And globalization is making our cultures evolving, and we're sticking to the new cultures, which are better. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And over here.
I'm Varun Sharma from Aga Khan, Uganda, Kampala. Okay, my point is basically I'm really going against this motion because childhood is actually going with a progress. This is because we are born to express, not to impress. So when we all have this protection given by our parents, because when you're, like, let me give you a metaphoric representation. We are like a seed. You only protect it, you water it so that it can become a perfect tree. And that's what the UN and all these programs are doing. So the childhood is actually becoming perfect.
Thank you for sharing that. And over here up at the top.
The opposition has said that we can do all these things outside now. We can go out and visit a park. We can do all these things. But I would like to clarify it that we simply don't. We spend more time on our screens than any time in the past 50 years. We're increasingly addicted. When I observe people in public, I don't see anyone talking to each other anymore. Couples sit next to each other, but they're in chains 1,000 miles away from each other. And no one's motivated to talk to each other anymore. And instead of scrolling, we like.
Thank you for sharing that.
How is this not perfect? How is this perfect? How is this not perfect?
And down here in the middle.
My name is Alina Jung and I'm from Jinsei High School. I felt like a lot of the points made from the debate was generalized and subjective. For example, how wars and camps were mentioned from the past, but that's neglecting the children who are still going through their plight right now. Just because we are living an affluent life doesn't mean every other child in the world think the same and feel the same about their childhood. I feel like the debate could have been more diplomatic.
And up here in the top left.
Hello, my name is Devesh and I'm from Aga Khan. So I'd like to ask the negators and the affirmatives, when are you actually going to talk about the major issues? Kids are getting drug addicts every single day. Rehabilitation centers are getting filled. Girls are getting raped. They're getting pregnant under the age of 18. Why aren't we talking about such matters? In Syria, you say life is perfect. Kids are dying at the age of 1. Infant mortality rate is increasing. So why don't you actually start the real debate?
And back up here.
I think the affirmative side was a little contradictive because speaker number 1 and speaker number 4 said that we're being spoon-fed, but we're also told to grow up a little faster. I mean, we have to give exams and everything, so that's a little contradictive. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you. And back here in the middle.
I'm Jung Nguyen Khoa from High School for the Gifted, Vietnam. I have a comment for affirmative team and a comment for the negative team. First thing for affirmative team, you use the past to compare with the present, but then in your last speaker statement, you prefer to the future. You haven't proven. I'm sorry to say that. And a comment for the negative team, I really impressed by the third speaker, James Gibson. But I really have to say one rebuttal to your last speaker and you, is that
all right.
Quality isn't always as happiness.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Scholars, remember, we're not giving individual or team feedback. Please just continue the discussion, share any ideas that you have that maybe were not included already in the debate.
Thank you. My name is Albert from Head Start International School, Phuket. I would just like to say that the motion seems a bit too much in general, because I want to say that we children are all different in a way, and that the way other children live might be better than other children. So we can't really prove that all children are getting, their way of life is getting worse or better. And that's the problem, is that we are all just generalizing this whole thing too much. Thank you.
And we'll move back up here, just kind of continue around this way.
Hi, my name's Alexia from St. Christopher's in Bahrain. And my point is for the negative team mainly. None of the teams have actually realized that the balance is the same. There might have been a different weight before, but the things that have been good and bad in the past and in the present are still balanced. They're still the same. And they haven't actually realized that, neither did they use it to their advantage. And my question is, why not? That is a really good point.
Thank you for sharing that. Back in the center of the room, could we get the timer to start at the beginning of each audience member's comments? Okay, each time a new speaker, if we could just get that up there, that would be great.
Hi, I'm Shruti Ratnaville from Wales International School, and I just wanted to ask the negative team, when they spoke about stress and how that hasn't actually gotten worse since the dawn of time, as they put it, but it is getting worse because there's more competition nowadays. And then after that, they spoke about how stress can be lessened, but I didn't really understand what they meant by that, because if they meant therapy or something like that, that isn't being provided to every child who is undergoing that kind of stress. Thank you.
Thank you. In the back of the room over here. Please introduce us, yourself.
My name is Dave, but on the point on happiness, polls have shown that happiness has decreased since World War II, and suicide rates in children have increased ever since the education system has been increasing. For example, a statistic in 2011 alone showed that 3 students die in South Korea from exam stress.
Okay, thank you. And over here in the back. Tell us your name.
All right, so my name is Ashwin Jagadishan, and I'm from India, and I am in strong support of the affirmative, and here's why. The opposition clearly stated that the improved globalization and the internet acts as a form of advancement. My question is simple. When a 10-year-old has access to stuff like pornography, how is that investment? And also, if there's excessive censorship, then there are a lot of problems that arise. And so how do you protect children in this new world?
Those are great questions to ask. Back in the center here.
Hey, my name is Sarah from Abu Dhabi. I just wanted to bring to your attention generally to the whole debate. You seem to talk about global peace. However, as somebody already mentioned, in LICs you have honorable killings for young brides, which is part of their childhood. However, we all seem to forget that even in HICs, you have segregation, children growing up in environments that are 100% unacceptable, where you have Black Lives Matter, and you have the issues with LGBT, and children are not free to express themselves. So just generally, not only in LICs and HICs, children aren't free to express themselves. Thank you.
Yep, over here in the red shirt in the back.
Hello, my name is Bill, and I'm representing Morrison Academy Kaohsiung from Taiwan. And first of all, I want to comment on the direction of the debate. You talked a lot about culture and first world problems, about bracelets reflecting the culture that you have, that people aren't allowed to climb trees anymore. But in the world, 1 in 9 children starve to death, as statistics are from WHO. Mortality rates are higher than they have been in the last 100 years. Our survivorship curves are more like that of birds. So if children are dying, how is childhood becoming more perfect? How is it not becoming more imperfect? Thank you.
Hey, thank you, audience. Can you please show everyone respect? I'm not sure what was on the screen, if I missed something, but please show those who are speaking respect by allowing them to speak and be heard. And back over here.
Hi, my name is Naima Bashir from Rusinga School, Nairobi. And one of the affirmative speakers said that children don't get enough opportunities, but you're sitting on that stage because opportunity brought you here. So how is it that children these days are not getting enough opportunities? We have more opportunities than ever before. So how is it that childhood is becoming more imperfect? Thank you.
And down in the middle of the room, tell us your name and what you'd like to share.
Hi, my name is Faye, and I'm from the British School of Khabairat. Now, the negative mostly spoke about the privileged and the people who can actually afford to go to schools and everything, but you guys never looked at the people who live in absolute poverty. People who don't even have an education, who can't even go here. I mean, these guys, people who are living in absolute poverty, needs a chance, and they're not getting it. That's why it's becoming more imperfect. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that.
Hi, my name is Wangashi Mwaura from Kenya. And I think there are two factors that should have been considered while you were debating. First of all, is that mental diseases and mental health is being considered more nowadays than it was in the past years. People consider autism more, they consider depression more, and that's one factor that makes our childhood more perfect as the years drone on. And the second factor is that there's climate change and people are being affected by the environment. There's lifestyle diseases and there are things that have changed from last time when we could go out and breathe fresh air, and those should be considered.
Thank you. We have time for just a few more before we call our panel back up. So we'll just go around from each station one more time, and then we will call our panelists back out, and they will come up on stage. So over here, where the spotlight is at the moment.
Hi, my name is Diana Winda from Rusinga School, Nairobi. And I'd like to say that children's perspectives are being expanded more when they're young because there are programs such as work experience that are introduced to children at high school levels and below. So that gives them expansion and they're able to know what the real world is like. So they're eased into that. And there was a time where doctor, lawyer, teacher, and engineer were the only career paths considered, but now there are much more. And why say loss of culture? Why not invention of new ones?
Thank you for sharing that. Here in the middle of the room.
Hi, my name is Andrei. I'm from Slovenia. And I would just like to say that the negative team was constantly focusing on the worst historical eras for children, like World War II and the Industrial Revolution in the 19th century, while completely forgetting like the eras in between. The quality of children's life, their childhoods, is constantly going up and down, and it's just going down now, according to statistics and research, as other speakers has said before, like more suicides and stuff. So.
All right. Thank you for that. And two more over here.
Hello, I'm Sebastian Santoni from the International School of London, Qatar. And I was surprised that not many speakers talked about the perspectives of the children themselves, as they spoke about the abstract parts of childhood and not the physical parts. Because even in this year's literature selection, The Stolen Child by William Butler Yeats, it talks about how children see the world as perfect and how they see it themselves. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Olivia and I'm from Hong Kong. And I just wanted to say that I felt that this debate was very interesting and that you're all very gifted speakers. But at the same time, I feel that a lot of the points you made are also quite general. You could have looked up more statistics and factual evidence, especially to do with things like national happiness and the impact of the environment and some other points you mentioned. And I also felt that you oversimplified the debate between cultural clashes and globalization, and that there should have been more evidence than just anecdotal examples.
All right. Let's move into the audience or the panelists with a little more of a positive note. If we could go back here to the middle one last time.
Hi, my name is Kosuke Tominaga. I'm from SKG Makuhari, and it's in Japan. I'd like to say that, first of all, information and globalization and the advance in technology has allowed us to have a wide variety of information, and the information we receive is actually very shallow, but that gives us a chance to pursue it in the future. So that I think I'm opposed to the motion.
All right, and that is all we have time for audience input. Give yourselves a round of applause. Not all of you were able to share your ideas. I'm sure there's many more out there. We are ready for our panelists to come up to the stage. Could someone please lead those panelists up here? And make some noise for the panelists as they come up on the stage. I'm going to turn it over to the panelists. They are going to share some feedback, some brief feedback for each team, and then dramatically announce which team they've decided as the winning team.
Hey everyone, so we're going to give some general comments first. So we felt that there were really strong rebuttals on both sides, and there were such strong personalities, and I think that we should really congratulate them on that. However, I feel that the definitions overall were a bit inconsistent and contradicted themselves a little bit, but I think that overall they had really good,
Yeah, on the point of definitions, we wanted to propose just an idea, a more conceptual approach that we felt was a bit neglected with too many specific examples that were given. For instance, the affirmative team could have said, saying that childhood is becoming more imperfect, that nothing can do anything but become more imperfect, because perfection is something that's only conceptual and can never exist practically. Or then on the other side of that, the negative team conceptually could have taken it to mean that there is no such thing as imperfection, because it's no one's place to draw an arbitrary line between something that is perfect and ideal and something that's not.
I would like to first start by praising and congratulating both sides of the team for your excellent work. And one thing specifically to the Affirma team, you guys brought up a very good point by bringing in relationships between parents and your children. However, one thing, as the panelist has already brought up, definitions for childhood, for example, could have brought up. Childhood can be defined as ages from infancy all the way to 7 years old, or all the way into teenagers. So that could be one thing that you guys could work on, but you guys did amazing.
I would like to give my feedback to the affirmative team. First of all, I would like to say that they all had a very stylistic way of speaking that was entirely their own, and they were able to project a sort of personality and persona on this debate. However, I felt like their examples were a little too general. Or they were targeted too specifically. They talked about the World Scholars Cup. However, the World Scholars Cup isn't the entire world, and they could have used examples such as facts and statistics.
Okay, so I'm gonna give my feedback to the negative side, and mine is pretty much positive feedback. One thing that I think that the negative team did really well, that I think that all people need to do in their debates, is they gave their reasons, they gave their justifications, X, Y, and Z, and then they continued to bring it back to the resolution. They repeated the resolution 3 or 4 times. They gave reason X, Y, Z, and that is why that childhood is not becoming more imperfect. And I feel like that summarized all of their points and continued to bring it back to the resolution and prove their point better.
I'm going to give a feedback to the negative team, but their style, I think that their style of speech was like awesome, but in some ways they were over passionate, and like I understand we get excited in front of this audience, but I think being over passionate sometimes sometimes doesn't convince people that well. Another point was like they sometimes generalized the facts, and they could work harder on it. Thank you.
Okay, I will be summarizing the facts for the negative team. I believe that the negative team overall performed really well because of one primary factor that was not found in the affirmative team, which was, ladies and gentlemen, personalization. They could relate it to the World Scholars Cup community, they could relate it to their own family in some cases, and in many cases as well, they could relate it to the international community, and that's what kind of gave them the advantage, because it gave them examples that substantiated their arguments, and that's, yeah, thanks, comrades.
So for the moment you've all been waiting for, we will be announcing the winner. Should we get a drum roll? Drum roll?
Your winning team of the 2016 Global Round is the negative team!
Everybody make some noise for all the people up on stage in the debate showcase. Debate showcase teams, please shake hands. And that is your 2016 Senior Debate Showcase. Coming up next is the Scholars Show.
And scholars, guess what? Y'all are done with all the academic things in the World Scholars Cup! Y'all are done! And so from this point on, it's party time, it's celebration, and it's also an announcement about the flag march. Everyone, put your hands together for Sara.
That's tough.